Hello everyone, welcome to this Advanced Energy Economy webinar. We're going to give folks a couple of minutes just to log on and then the webinar will begin. Thanks very much and stand by. We will begin the webinar in just a moment. Hello everyone, welcome to the webinar. The title of this webinar is State of Advanced Energy 2019, Markets, Jobs, and Trends. I'm Robert Keough, Senior Vice President of Content at AEEE. I will be moderator and presenter today with an excellent panel to fill out the program. Remind you all that this webinar is being recorded. It will be archived on the AEEE website, but it'll also be distributed to all attendees within 48 hours after the conclusion of the webinar. I will be presenting the main findings on market size of advanced energy globally and in the US, drawing on our recently published Advanced Energy Now 2019 market report, and we'll be focusing today on the U.S. market for advanced energy technologies and services. Then we've got executives from two AEEE member companies who will provide perspective on two major growth segments of advanced energy. Mark Goodwin, CEO of Apex Clean Energy, will speak about the renewable energy market. And Brian Marano of Nissan will discuss electric vehicles. Then we'll turn our focus to employment. We've got labor market researcher Phil Jordan, who'll present employment findings based on the data from the latest National Energy and Employment Report. And finally, we have AEEE CEO Nat Kramer, who will provide context on what AEEE is doing to keep the advanced energy growth going. So let's start by taking a look at market for advanced energy. And this is all based on the Advanced Energy Now 2019 market report. As we define advanced energy, it includes a wide range of technologies and services that make the energy we use secure, clean, and affordable. We categorize advanced energy in seven segments, addressing both supply and demand. Within those segments, we cover 41 subsegments shown here in this table, and more than 80 different products and services. Our partner in the market report, Navigant Research, collects revenue data on an annual basis, covering both US and global markets. And this year's report includes data from 2011 to 2018. Advanced Energy Now Market Report is the most comprehensive assessment of advanced markets available anywhere, but it also is inherently conservative in nature. There are some product categories for which there are no solid data available. And even where the data is available, Navigant employs a very conservative definition of what constitutes advanced in energy. So as to clearly distinguish the products and services that are better than standard rather than capturing those that are well-established and traditional. So our estimates of market size for advanced energy should be considered very conservative. But let's take a look at what we've got this year. Total worldwide revenue for advanced energy in 2018 was $1.6 trillion, an increase of $64 billion over 2017, or 4% growth year over year. That makes advanced energy worldwide equal in revenue to global tourism, greater than pharmaceutical spending, and double that of the global airline industry. From 2011 to 2018, the compound annual growth rate for global advanced energy was 6%. In the US, advanced energy is a $238 billion market in 2018, up $25 billion from 2017. That makes advanced energy equal to aerospace manufacturing in the US and twice the size of the biotech industry. Advanced energy had a big year last year. Its growth was 11%, nearly four times the growth rate of US GDP overall. As you can see from this graph, 2011 to 2018, advanced energy grew at a compound annual rate of 8%. Now let's take a look at some key market segments. We're going to start with building efficiency, which is the biggest segment of the U.S. advanced energy market. It was $883.1 billion in revenue in 2018. That's 10% growth from over 2017. In fact, the building efficiency market has grown every year since we began tracking. And just counting the products for which we have data since 2011, compound annual growth for building efficiency has been 11%. Advanced electricity generation is another large and growing segment of U.S. Advanced energy and was up 8% in 2018 to nearly $60 billion. Within advanced electricity generation, renewable energy technologies are some that we follow closely. Solar PV was up 8% in 2018 and almost matched the peak year of 2016 in revenue. With prices in solar PV continuing to fall, that 8% revenue growth supported 14% growth in installed megawatts. Combined annual growth for solar PV from 2011 to 2018 was 17%. Wind energy also had a strong year in 2018. It was up 23% over 2017. In that, wind returned to the roughly $14 billion in annual revenue we've seen in three of the past 4 years. This strong, steady revenue in recent years compares favorably to the boom and bust cycle we saw earlier in the decade due to uncertainty over the fate of the production tax credit. For more insight into the U.S. market for renewable energy, let me turn to Mark Goodwin, CEO of Apex Clean Energy. Apex is a major developer and operator of large-scale wind and solar power facilities across North America. Mark is a board member of AEE, and Apex is a sponsor of the 2019 market report. Mark, what do you see as the major trends driving the market for renewable energy in the U.S. today?
Today, what is happening in utility scale is really a strong increase in the corporate power purchasing market. And that has driven like a strong current market for projects that are being built in 2019, 2020, and eventually in 2021. Really would like to just talk about the broader market. So today, in the first quarter, the wind industry announced an increase of 6 gigawatts to a total of 40 gigawatts of late stage or under construction projects. So those are projects that will be delivered this year, 2020 or 2021. Part of that is being driven by the phase out of the PTC, but what we're seeing is that 2021 is a year where it will be the first year that the phase out kicks in that you'll be able to gain 80% of the full value of the PTC, and 2020 is the last year where you're 100%. So in 2021, we're still seeing strong interest from power purchasers, and turbine suppliers had one of their best years ever in safe harbor orders that they do in order for projects to qualify for the PTC. So that suggests that it will be a great year. And you know, there is a possibility in 2021 that prices will go up on the wind side, but a lot of that is being made up for by efficiencies in the financing and improvements in the turbine technology. Also on the wind side of things, right now, 8 states are on track to double their installed wind capacity in 2019 and 2020. And currently there are 17 gigawatts of wind projects that are under construction. Going back to corporate power purchase agreements, the first quarter saw the second strongest volume ever of power purchase agreements with 2,700 megawatts of corporate and almost 2,700 megawatts of utility PPAs. On the solar side of things, the solar prices continue to dramatically decrease. You know, 9 years ago, the total combined amount of electricity that was supplied by solar was 0.1%, and today that is 2%, and rising rapidly. By the end of 2018, there are 25 gigawatts of contracted utility scale solar projects on the grid. I spoke earlier about the phase out of the production tax credit. We're seeing demand that is staying strong. And the reason that that is the case is because many of the corporate power purchasers that have goals related to their operational carbon footprint are only scratching the surface of what they need in order to mitigate their carbon. And one of the key ways that they're doing that is through wind and solar PPAs. So although on the wind side, the price may tick up, the demand is there such that we'll still continue to see the strong growth in both wind and solar. The other thing that's driving demand is the renewable portfolio standards. And that is happening. Almost every state in the U.S. has a voluntary or mandatory RPS. And recently with the Paris Climate Accord, many states have gotten more aggressive in what their goals are. For instance, California has passed legislation that would have them be 100% clean energy by 2045. New York State is passing more aggressive goals, and the list goes on and on of states that have very high penetration of clean energy in year 2030 or year 2050. And if wind and solar is built out to meet those goals, we need to be building probably twice or three times as much as we're building today. And right now we're at record capacity in both wind and solar. So the market is very strong, and we expect it to continue to be strong in 2020 and 2021. And I'll pass it back to you, Bob.
Thank you, Mark. Let's take a look at another key market segment, advanced transportation. Advanced transportation revenue grew more than any other market segment in 2018 in both dollars and percent growth. It was up $7.9 billion to over $30 billion in 2018. That growth was driven primarily by growth in revenue from plug-in electric vehicles, which was up 75% to $18 billion in 2018. So you can see from the graph, revenue growth in EVs in the past 5 years has been exponential. Similarly, revenue growth has been strong in EV charging infrastructure as well. Revenue there was up 23% in 2018 to $280 million, following a similar jump in 2017. To get more insight about the burgeoning EV market, let me turn to Brian Marano, Director of EV Operations for Nissan North America. Nissan, as you all know.
Thanks, Bob. Appreciate it. Good afternoon, and good morning to everyone. So on the plug-in electric vehicle side, and I'll talk about infrastructure as well, charging infrastructure. But first on electric vehicle side, battery electric vehicles in 2018, which is aligned to the $18 billion in revenue, it's about 20 vehicles in market in the U.S. came out to 360,000 units sold. And by 2025, what we'll see is more than double the number of options out there in terms of vehicle selection. We forecast about 54 cars. That comes from IHS. IHS is kind of the industry standard right now for development of electric vehicle market and models. So 54 EV models, and we'll be on the cusp of 1 million sales. It'll be over 900,000 units. But it will be somewhere just below 1 million. Could be higher, but our all indications point to it being somewhere around the 950,000 unit. Now that excludes plug-in hybrids. Plug-in hybrids will continue in the marketplace, but you're going to see a shift from fewer plug-in hybrids and more battery electric vehicles in the marketplace as batteries advance and become less costly, and charging infrastructure it develops further. And speaking of charging infrastructure, what we see there is tremendous growth as well. And this is really important. Somewhere between 3 and 6% of all driving in the U.S. Is comprised of trips that are over 100 miles. So it's very small on a percentage basis, but it's significant in the fact that people in the U.S. specifically do drive longer distances, and it may only be once or twice a year. And when those instances come up, when it comes to deciding on what vehicle you're going to buy, you need to have something that can do everything for you. So the importance of infrastructure isn't so much the daily usage by a single driver. It could be measured on the annual usage, that 3 to 6%. Once we get infrastructure to the place where it's going, that's going to open up a lot of doors. Of course, battery range, vehicle range, autonomous range will grow, but having the necessary infrastructure of high power charging will be imperative to growing the market, and that's coming. So in 2018, from a charging perspective, aligned to the $280 million in revenue, about 11,400 fast chargers in the U.S. That includes CHAdeMO standard, CCS, and Tesla superchargers. And by 2021, that goes from 11.4 in 18 to 19,000 in 21. So not quite double, but significant increase. A big driver of that is obviously going to be through Electrify America, the subsidiary of Volkswagen. That came out of the Dieselgate settlement, and that's really going to change a lot of the makeup. It'll also include, obviously, that's the largest initiative, but it'll also include investments from OEMs such as us, BMW, Ford. We'll also continue our investments in the public infrastructure space. So we've spent and Nissan spent over $60 million in the last 5 years. To grow infrastructure through a program we call No Charge to Charge. Essentially, it's a market-based program that we have for our Nissan LEAF drivers. It's available in 57 markets across the U.S. It covers 92% of our sales. There's 2,000 chargers that are part, fast chargers that are part of the program. And all the chargers are located within 10 miles, around 10 miles of our customer base within those markets. So programs like that, and we'll continue to invest in and grow with our partner EVgo, will supplement what's happening with EA. We're also doing things, and this is an important point. We finished a northeastern corridor that links Boston to Washington, D.C. along I-95, about 500 miles. And the importance of that is there's a couple of important points to this initiative. There's 9 locations and 52 chargers. So that averages to about 6 chargers per site. And that 6 chargers per site is significant because one of the needs from an infrastructure perspective is redundancy. Having one or even 2 chargers available at a given site is really not enough. If you think about a fueling station, you rarely see, unless it's a very rural location, you rarely see or never see only 1 or 2 gas pumps. It's more like 6 or more. So that's equally as important for the electric vehicle charging infrastructure needs of the consumer. If a charger's down, if it's a popular location, a lot of people are using it, people aren't going to be prone to wait. Also, the importance of is the linking of the metros and connecting Boston, New York, Philadelphia, Washington, D.C. That's also important. And what is on top of that important are the locations, obviously, of the chargers. So they're all located fairly closely off of the highway with good visibility. So initiatives like that will help support the market, but will also validate the market. When people see that the infrastructure is there, they'll be more prone to adopt into an EV lifestyle. And finally, I was talking about Electrify America earlier, and most of this is public information. I think this is all public information, but their Cycle 2 initiative, which will be their next 30-month stage of the 10-year settlement requirements, will include 215 additional sites that they'll be installing in. That will bring them to a total of 700 sites, and because they'll have completed 484 in cycle one. And now most of those sites that they'll be adding, those 215 in cycle two, will be 150 kilowatt capable public chargers within 18 metro locations. So that's the last point I'll make relative to charging. Throughput is imperative as well. Right now, most chargers, except for Tesla, the CCS and CHAdeMO chargers that are out there are 50 kW. And now moving to 150 kW obviously increases the throughput, which benefits the customer from a convenience perspective. It's less time charging. And especially as batteries become larger, it'll take longer to charge them on anything less. So that's the other direction that that the market's going. Faster chargers in the public space, and also from a competitive perspective within our industry, faster capability on the vehicle side itself. So the vehicles have to be able to accept the faster rate of charge, which is another place where the development is happening and where you'll see advances and more manufacturers offering vehicles that have faster charging throughput capability. Thank you very much, Bob. I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you, Brian. And I'd like to note that Nissan is a new member of Advanced Energy Economy, joining our growing contingent of companies who are working with us to electrify transportation. Before we finish up the discussion of markets, I'd like to point to 2 other product segments of note in the 2019 market report. Energy storage is a technology that is revolutionizing the electric power system, and we see it growing very strongly in 2018. It was up 18% last year, reaching just over $700 million, following even bigger growth years in 2016, when it went up 54%, and 2017, when it grew 39%. So very strong growth in this exciting new area of advanced energy. Also of some note is developments in the advanced metering infrastructure category. Smart meters saw a comeback in the past 2 years. There had been a slow decline in revenue in the years following the spending that was stimulated by the Federal Recovery Act early in the decade. But that turned around in 2017 when revenue jumped 81% to $1.2 billion. Revenue declined just a bit last year, but still at $1.1 billion in 2018, smart meter revenue stayed in shouting distance of the peak of $1.4 billion in 2011 and 2012. So that concludes our look at market sizes and growth. Now let's turn to jobs. Let me introduce Phil Jordan, Vice President and Principal Researcher for BW Research Partnership. He is the preeminent labor market researcher focused on our industry. Under Phil's leadership, BW Research produces data for the annual Energy and Employment Report for Energy Futures Initiative in partnership with NASIO, now for the second year, and before that, for the U.S. Department of Energy. Phil, tell us what you found in advanced energy employment nationally in 2018.
Great. Thanks so much, Bob, and thanks to everyone for joining this webinar. First, why don't I tell you a little bit about the underlying data collection efforts so that we can demonstrate where the data come from and how we go about generating the figures, and then we'll talk a bit about the importance of advanced energy jobs to our economy. So as Bob mentioned, the data collection is part of now a four-year effort that has been a seamless transition from the federal government under the Department of Energy to now a project led by Energy Futures Initiative and NASIO. It is a survey-based methodology that serves as a supplement to the quarterly census of employment and wages. So we essentially overlay the data that we collect from about 30,000 employers each year over existing statistics from the federal government and from state labor agencies. The way that we ask the questions allows us to segment jobs by the different components of advanced energy. So it's a modular methodology that allows us to pull out not only the major categories like generation and distribution and building efficiency, but also the sub-technologies within each of those, like solar and wind, building materials and biofuels. And really what we're doing is we're not creating any new categories or double counting any kinds of jobs. We're simply filtering existing jobs and new job creation into each of these categories. So what I mean by that is we are looking at manufacturing of appliances and looking to see how many jobs are associated with the manufacture of Energy Star appliances as opposed to non-Energy Star as an example, or tracking the job transformation from coal technology to advanced natural gas. So this is how we're able to track these changes and the transformation of the energy economy as it moves, as I think the market data show very clearly, as they move towards the advanced technologies. So the last point on methodology here before we go to the next slide is just that we do actually collect information on jobs at a variety of levels. So what I mean by that is we want to count people who are 100% working in advanced energy technologies, as well as those who are just spending a portion of their time. So we're looking at exclusive worker, looking at majority time workers, and we're looking at time less majority workers so that we can understand these transformations as they happen state by state in real time. If we move to the next slide, we can see just how big advanced energy is and just how important it is to the US economy. So advanced energy now supports 3.5 million jobs as of the end of 2018. And as you can see from this slide, you know, this is significantly bigger than retail establishments, than the accommodations, the hotels and motels industry, and more than three times the size of coal and oil combined. So we're talking about a major segment and a major employer and a major job creator. And if we flip to the next slide, we can actually see that not only is it bigger, but it's growing faster. So at 3.8% employment growth, that's more than double the overall growth rate of all jobs in the United States. Advanced Energy over the years has consistently outperformed in terms of job growth, consistently outperformed jobs as a whole. And the interesting thing about this number is that it's done so despite some volatility within Advanced Energy. So, you know, as we know, the solar coaster of jobs after a decade of double-digit growth, we've seen some changing business models and some other challenges in terms of employment in that industry as it's gone up and down. But generally speaking, despite that volatility, we're still seeing an industry that's punching above its weight in terms of economic growth. If we go to the next slide, we can see the breakdown of these jobs. And you know, about 2.3 million of these jobs are in energy efficiency for buildings. So this includes everything from the manufacture of energy efficient products and the research and development that goes into that, as well as the installation and maintenance of energy efficiency measures, whether it's building envelope or lighting, heating and cooling, all big segments. I'll just note here that one of the interesting findings over the last few years is that as the unemployment rate in the United States goes down and jobs continue to grow, we are seeing employers starting to report increased difficulty in finding qualified talent, particularly around energy efficiency in the installation space. So one of the key findings from the report this year is that we need, as we shine a spotlight, as AEE shines a spotlight on advanced energy jobs and their importance to the economy, we also need to make sure that we are continuing to support those people who are currently unemployed and on the sidelines, and those training providers that can get them into the market. But as you can see in this chart here on your screen, we see obviously building efficiency at 2/3, followed by advanced generation, which is a very fast-growing segment there in advanced natural gas, which I think is probably not a surprise to anyone on this call. We've seen really fast growth year over year, the fastest in advanced vehicles, so that's exciting. I'm glad that we had representative from Nissan to talk about the excitement in the EV market. So this is a 15 to 25% growth across those categories. Also, sort of echoing that growth is really starting to accelerate in electric vehicles, and slower growth in hybrids, which again is consistent with our market experts here on the call. We're also seeing really exciting growth in storage, and that's an area that I think is really exciting going forward. So all in all, I think what we find in looking at these two reports side by side is a lot of consistency, and again, just additional evidence about the importance of advanced energy to the U.S. economy. That it is large, when you compare it to other industries that are also important to the U.S. economy, we see that it is. It is large and important, and it's also growing fast. So it's creating opportunities for more and more Americans, which really does continue to demonstrate its importance. So Bob, I think with that I could turn it back to you to continue the remarks on the implications of these studies.
Great, thanks so much, Phil. Now let me introduce Nat Kramer, CEO of AEE. For some comments on the industry overall and on the approach AEE is taking to consolidate and accelerate industry growth. Nat, over to you.
Thanks, Bob, and thanks for everybody participating on this call and listening in, for investing your time with us today. AEE advances the policy interests of an entire ecosystem of companies building a clean, secure, and affordable energy and transportation system. because U.S. energy policy is made and implemented by states and wholesale market operators, we focus exclusively on securing policy wins that protect and expand the total addressable market for advanced energy companies operating within them. Focusing on those markets and jurisdictions allows us to outflank the gridlock morass in DC so we can achieve wins in many markets simultaneously. Our unique approach is invaluable to policy leaders that have to represent the interests of an entire market, which includes governors, commissioners, and legislative leadership, effectively where power is concentrated in politics. We educate these policy leaders and cultivate advanced energy and transportation champions among them, and that allows us to consistently secure policy wins. So for example, in the last year, AEEE wrote the energy policies for 7 newly elected governors and secured the appointment of 20 AEEE trained and approved candidates to key leadership positions in energy within states. This allows us to shape the landscape to our unique competitive advantage, and we translate that advantage into wins. For example, and there are many examples of this, we recently worked with the new governor of Nevada to double the RPS. We capitalized on the energy plan we developed with the new governor of Virginia and corresponding legislation we helped pass to enact it to expand the efficiency market in Virginia by $1 billion. And we protected NIPSCO's plan to repower with 100% clean energy by stopping the Pence-Pruitt-led coal mining interests who were seeking to keep coal plants running in Indiana. When you look around the advanced energy economy at the institutions that are advocating on your behalf for policy wins, I think you will quickly see that AEEE has unique competitive advantages that are representing you, and we're executing those in the markets where we can get demonstrable results that affect your business today. Thank you.
Thank you, Nat. That concludes our program at this point. If you are interested in more data on advanced energy markets, I encourage you to download the Advanced Energy Now 2019 Market Report with global and U.S. revenue from 2011 to 2018, segment by segment analysis of trends driving that growth. We will be serializing excerpts from the market report on our blog as well, but you can download it. The full report or highlights, a two-page highlight sheet at AEEE.net or at advancedenergynow.org. For jobs information, we have a two-page fact sheet on advanced energy employment in the U.S., 3.5 million U.S. advanced energy jobs, employment by segment. That is also available for download at AEEE.net. Last but not least, let me point you toward a couple of important upcoming events. Our first two regional energy policy conferences, beginning with Advanced Energy Now East next month, June 13th, in Richmond, Virginia, with some excellent speakers and panelists lined up. And in October, we'll be having our West Regional Conference, Advanced Energy Now West, in Scottsdale, Arizona, October 16th and 17th. Details on that will be coming soon. That concludes our program. Thank you for attending the webinar. Thank you to our panelists for all the helpful information. Again, the recording of this webinar will be available on our website and also distributed to all of you in the next 48 hours. And we look forward to seeing you at our next webinar. Thank you and have a good day.